Hello, hello, and welcome. First of all, I'm really excited about this educational opportunity. Today, we get to talk about bulletproofing your feet for movement longevity. Now, we'll give it a couple minutes before we get started. And one thing that I like to do when we start these things, I always think it's cool to see where in the world everyone is coming from, because we typically have students from all over the world. This also gives you an opportunity to find the chat and kind of the Q&A sections on this webinar if you have never used GoToWebinar before. But yeah, if you're able to share something like that, that's great. It's really exciting for us to see where in the world everyone is coming from. Again, this is an exciting one for me because today we get to hear from someone that I got to learn quite a bit from, and someone that's influenced me over the years and influenced the way that I train myself. And definitely how I trained some of my clients over the years. So again, we'll give it another minute or two before we jump all the way in. But again, today, some great information, some great prizes that are gonna be coming your way at the end, and also some opportunities for discounts on products from Dr. Emily herself and from ISSA. So Dr. Emily, I think I'm ready to get started, but we've given it a minute. We've got a good number of people here. So why don't we jump right in? Again, we're talking about bulletproofing your feet for movement longevity. So today, the agenda, what we're talking about, we're going to learn about activating the nervous system. And this is going to be a really important point to take away, because this is really going to be kind of the start of how you start to, improve foot health and improve function. Speaking of that, we're going to talk on integrating foot strength. And what that means is how we strengthen the feet and how that affects the rest of the body. We're going to talk about how stimulation of the feet can help with circulation and help with recovery. Then we get to do some Q&A. So please do get in the Q&A section and ask away with your questions. I'll take note of them, and we'll have a chance to ask Dr. Emily the questions at the end of our webinar today. And then keep in mind, we do have some prizes for you guys, and you are going to have to be present in order to win these prizes. So when we make the announcement at the end of this webinar, again, you will have to be present in order to win. And just one last thing, be sure, again, put your questions in the Q&A, in the chat, so that we can have an opportunity to ask Dr. Emily all of these questions at the end. All right, next up, a little bit about us and ISSA. We are the global leader in fitness and wellness certifications for over 30 years. Our vision at ISSA is to connect 100 million people to the power of healthy living by 2030. 2030 feels like something in the distant future. That number sounds so far out there, but that really is right around the corner. We have over 50 fitness and wellness certifications and specializations, and we have world-class student support, including success advisors, online support spaces, and live instructor-led classes for many of our courses. So a couple things about why today is important and some of the things that you might be able to take away from this presentation. Your feet are your biomechanical foundation. They're your little foundation, but they're also very much the foundation of a lot of the movement, a lot of the exercise that we do on a daily basis. Dr. Emily's gonna talk to us about stability and how that can influence hip strength. We're gonna learn a little bit more about how the feet are connected to the core via fascia lines. So if you want a functionally strong core, you better be taking care of those feet. We're gonna talk about how there are thousands of nerves in the feet that control movement. And then we get to talk about how this applies to your own personal fitness practice and your professional fitness practice. Okay, that's enough of me. I would like to introduce our speaker for today. We've got Dr. Emily Splickle. And again, she's someone that has a lot of great education out there, someone that I've learned a lot from and someone that I got to do some work for in the past. And her education definitely influenced the way that I take on my own personal practice, and it certainly influenced my professional practice. Dr. Emily, welcome. And if you could, please let our listeners know a little bit more about you.
Of course. Thank you so much, John. And thank you to everyone at ISSA for this opportunity. It is a pleasure. It's an honor to share with you a little bit about my background and how I look at fitness, but also about feet and how important it is to be bringing in some sort of foot-focused programming, cueing, recovery. And I'm going to demonstrate to you a very easy way to integrate this. So if you're already doing a little bit, perfect. If you've been curious to learn more about feet, then this is your opportunity. As John had said, my name is Dr. Emily Splickle. I go by Dr. Emily. I am a podiatrist. So I am a clinician. I'm also a human movement specialist, but very, very proud that I have been in the fitness industry for over 22 years. So I've been a personal trainer, I've taught group exercise, and now I'm primarily on the side of fitness education. And I do that primarily through my courses through BFA Global. ISSA actually just picked up some of our courses, including our barefoot training specialist. We'll have more information on that at the end. And then, of course, Novoso. Novoso is actually very integral to this webinar that we're doing today. So I am the CEO and founder of Novoso, and I'll be speaking about those products. A little social fun on the bottom. So if you want to say hello over there, make sure you check that out. But we are here to get some education. So my key takeaway for everyone through this hour is that I want you to understand that it is actually the consistent daily habits or rituals that you do every single day, nice and committed to them, that has this positive accumulative effect on your foot health. That's what we're talking about here is feet, but really it's movement longevity. And most of my messaging is built around how do you use foot strength, foot recovery, foot health to support really everyone's end goal, which is movement longevity. So consistent, make sure you're doing something daily. You want to train your clients to then be doing this daily as well. And it's through really easy, simple steps. You're just talking like 5 minutes a day, every day has an awesome accumulative effect. So what we're going to do is we're going to go into the pyramid of healthy feet. So you can think of this as the three layers of what I want you guys to start integrating with yourselves and your clients starting today. On the bottom of that pyramid is going to be activation, waking up, stimulating. Once we have that activation layer, then we want to build strength. So strength on top of these activated feet. And then, of course, recovery is going to be on the top. So we got activation, strength, and recovery. You can also think about healthy feet, movement longevity, based off of three different systems. And we're going to explore these three systems as well. Of course, the one on the bottom right, musculoskeletal, it's very obvious. We probably assume that there would be some sort of musculoskeletal reference. However, I want you to also appreciate the really powerful nervous system influence that foot health has on movement longevity. And honestly, as I go further into my career, most of my passion actually lies within the nervous system, the brain. Just it's really what is influencing movement and performance and recovery is that nervous system. And then finally, lower left, we've got our circulatory system. Really important that you cannot underappreciate the importance of having a healthy lymphatic system, healthy blood flow to and from the area that you're trying to recover. So that's going to be the last little piece that we'll cover throughout this. Let's get started. Step one, bottom of the pyramid, activation, waking up. Obviously, we're talking about nerves, your nervous system, all the way down at your feet. This is going to be your peripheral nervous system. And when we think about your peripheral nervous system, we actually can break this down a little bit more specific, because that's what we do is we get into the nitty gritty. You can break down your peripheral nervous system or the nerves into two main types. Now, most people, when they think about the nerves in the feet and the ankle, they're going to use the word proprioceptors or proprioception. And many of you would probably say, yes, this is how I refer to ankle stability in the nervous system, right? If we're training on a wobble board, a BOSU, you're doing any sort of balance exercises, that is going to be quote unquote proprioceptive, right? And ankle stability, movement stability is based around proprioception. Now, I'm here to tell you that it's not that simple, that you actually can break it down a little bit more. There are another type of nerves that are called mechanoceptors. So now when you think about the foot and the ankle, I want you to think of both proprioception and mechanoception, okay? So we're gonna go back to the first one that we're familiar with, which is proprioception. Proprioceptors, muscle spindle, GTOs, if you remember that from your personal training exam, right? These are found within your joint capsules. So every joint, doesn't matter the joint in the body, is surrounded by a capsule, which is a soft tissue web that is blending into the ligaments, retinaculum, you have the tendons that come out of it. So there's a lot of fascia, and then obviously it blends into your fascia. So it's very connective tissue fascial rich around a joint. And why those nerves are around the joint is they are signaling stretch. So when you move a joint, that stretch to the capsule and the proprioceptors tells your brain where that joint is in space. That's referred to as joint position sense. So how does this go back to your clients and performance and movement? Is movement accuracy, movement stability, athletic performance is based off of very rapid perception of joint position and any shift in joint position. So you want to make sure that your clients are very proprioceptively aware because that gives them better body control. Okay, so we need to wake up those proprioceptors. I'm going to go into a little bit on how you can do that. But right now, if you're doing anything that is unstable, wobble board, Bosu, Dynadisc, things like that, you're essentially targeting the proprioceptive system of that ankle, of the foot and the ankle. Now, another one that I speak about in other courses that I have through EBFA is that your proprioceptors are also very much based around carrying weight, so weight resistance. And you can think of proprioception like a hug. And when you wear compression apparel actually hugs your nervous system and stimulates proprioceptors. So anytime I'm trying to wake up the proprioceptors, I tell my clients or patients to wear compression apparel, to use wrist weights, weighted vests, because that essentially stimulates the proprioceptive system, or to hold something that is weighted. Like at Nebosa, we have a 2-pound stick. The 2 pounds when I hold this stick is technically pulling on my joint capsule, which is stimulating proprioceptors. So some fun tricks for you. Let's go to the other side, mechanoception. Now, mechanoception is my favorite because it has to do with barefoot science, barefoot stimulation, surface science, and all of the footwear science. But mechanoceptors are found in the skin in the bottom of your feet and the palm of your hand. This is called glabrous skin. This is called hairy skin. Glabrous skin, palms of hand, bottom of the feet, is unique skin that has unique mechanoceptors or touch receptors. Now, when you think of these mechanoceptors, you can break them down into two main groups. If you look at the slide, you can see that there's an SA and an FA. The SA means slow adapting. So they are constantly reading the environment. Great example for your hand is if I'm holding something like my coffee. It's not coffee, this is lemon water. But I'm holding something and I'm talking to you and there's this subconscious process happening over here to know exactly how hard to engage this cup so that I don't spontaneously drop it. That is based off of SA mechanoceptors, okay? Now in standing, because of course we're talking about feet, that would be standing in one place. That's called quiet stance. Quiet stance, we all have a little bit of a sway, and the SA mechanoceptors in the bottom of the feet constantly read underneath your feet to maintain upright posture. Now, the FA stands for fast adapting. So it responds to a stimulus and then shuts off, responds and then shuts off, which means the best way to stimulate FA mechanoceptors is through movement. Okay, so now real quick on here, how do you stimulate the different mechanoreceptors? Because this is important if you want to activate your feet. SA1 Merkel disc 2-point discrimination, also known as texture. This is actually the premise of everything behind Nobosu. You can see the image on the screen, or if I hold up one of our insoles, you can see that everything has these tiny little pyramids. And if I push my fingers on it, I'll do it on the neural ball, and I have the little dots, it kind of looks like Braille, which is exactly what we are stimulating. We stimulate the same nerve in your feet as your hand uses to read Braille, which is called your Merkel disc. So it's a very specific stimulus, which is very powerful. Your SA2 Ruffini ending is skin stretch. So this is when you might use some sort of kinesiology tape, any other sort of athletic tape, you can stimulate your Ruffini endings. And then real quick, your FA1, FA2 corpuscles, if you look at the slide, it says are sensitive to vibration. Where we experience vibration every single day through our feet is moving. So ground reaction forces are perceived by your nervous system through your feet and these corpuscles and is perceived as vibration. So real quick fun fact, if you need to use that vibration to understand how hard you're striking the ground, to create a loading response, to control movement, if you put lots of cushion in your shoes, guess what that does to that vibration? It absorbs the vibration, which means that the nerves in your feet don't get the stimulus. So it's a big part of where that minimal shoe argument lies is within your need to feel the vibration so that you can move well. Okay, now I just want to give you a quick foot fact around this is that your mechanoreceptors, the peak sensitivity of these nerves in the bottom of your feet is age 40. By the time you are 70, you need twice the stimulation to create the same response. So for all of my listeners right now, or if you're on the recording, if you are working with older clients, think about this. You need to make sure that you are stimulating their contact point with the ground, because if they cannot feel their feet, they cannot control their overall posture and their movement. So I'm very passionate around what I call barefoot baby boomers, because I want to get barefoot stimulation, especially in that aging population because of this. Okay. So great fun fact. So here's some tips on how to wake up and connect to our peripheral nervous system. Step one, think about the shoes your clients are wearing. Now, they don't have to go all the way barefoot, although I love being barefoot. They don't have to, depending where you're training, certain commercial facilities, you cannot do that. I understand it. Or could you train the client in the yoga studio, in the group X studio, so you could control the environment and take their shoes off? Could you go into more of a minimal shoe than a thick cushion shoe, right? So at least you're getting more of that stimulation into the foot. Or do you throw in something like a Nobosu insole or the socks, which are shown on the picture, and there you go. Even if they have cushion in their shoes, they got a sensory layer that is activating the feet. Your second, harder surfaces are always more stimulating than softer surfaces, which means if I had a choice, I would want to train my clients on a hardwood floor. I don't want to train my clients on thick, cushy carpet, on a wrestling mat. I want to get them on a surface that is harder. So try to think about that when you train your clients. Of course, Nobosu is a great way, and then releasing your feet. So studies have shown that if you do just a 5-minute trigger point release to the bottom of the feet, you get an immediate improvement in balance. How cool is that, right? So I love everyone to start their sessions, 5 minutes, release their feet, slide your shoes back on, totally fine. And then let's go have an awesome workout. It's just part of how I do my movement prep, okay? And that's what I wanna show you guys now is how to do a 5-point activation. Now here you can see in the picture that I'm using a neural ball. Of course, not everyone has a neural ball. That's totally fine, it's not required, because I'm going to just show you the 5 points, and then you could use a golf ball, a lacrosse ball, or if you want to check out the Nebosso Neuro Ball, then check it out. There's a reason why it's designed the way that it is that I'm going to show you momentarily. Let's see if this will play. Okay, so what I want to show here is, if you can see the video, there's 5 points in the bottom of the foot. It's a 5-point release. You're going to do each point for 30 seconds. So you can see the different points of where I am indicating on the foot. You got the heel, you got the middle of the arch, you have the ball of the foot, and then you have here the lateral side and then the medial side. So you got these 5 points is where you want to think about it, okay? And then what you're going to do is, if you have a neuro ball, if you want to check out the neuro ball, the ball is going to split into two pieces. So you can see that I'm pushing my heel down. It's going to split into two domes. The two domes are designed so that you can release both of your feet at the exact same time. It also allows you to do pinpoint pressure release much more effectively than with a golf ball or a lacrosse ball. So it keeps your hips nice and level without shifting those hips too asymmetrically, if you think of with like a lacrosse ball. Okay, added bonus is you obviously have the texture on top, and the texture is going to wake up those nerves, and it's also going to improve circulation, which is going to be the last thing that we're focusing on. So I'm just going to show you real quick here, so you can just see that I'm doing the 5 different points. I'm not going to go through all 5 points with it, but you have now the 5 points that you would stand and release. Remember, it's 30 seconds per point. If you have the neuro ball, you could do both feet at the same time. If you don't, check it out. But also, you could use lacrosse ball, tennis ball, golf ball, okay? So that's going to be a really important thing for activation. That's your step one. Step two, next higher level of the pyramid, is going to be strength. Now, when I talk about foot strength, the foot strength that I'm referencing is your deep foot muscles, these guys, the intrinsics. The intrinsic muscles of your feet originate and insert in your foot. You can think of them almost like your deep abdominal muscles, your pelvic floor, your transverse abdominals. And guess what? They actually connect to your pelvic floor and your deep pelvic muscles. So your deep core, or your deep foot core, your foot's core, is actually connected to your core, right? So I call that foot to core sequencing, foot to core stability. And these muscles very uniquely contract isometrically. Okay, so that's how we want to engage these. And guess what I'm going to teach you right now? How to do this in a very simple way. And then I go much, much more into this in the Barefoot Chinese Specialist Level 1. And I have many videos on YouTube. But when I refer to foot to core sequencing, strong feet, strong core is really what you're looking for with your clients. Because if you think about it, let's say if I'm doing a squat, a box jump, I'm throwing a ball, I'm doing a lunge, I'm doing a bicep curl, it doesn't matter, right? You need your center of gravity to be stable. And where's your center of gravity? Right? L5, S1, boom. That's where we need that stability. Why your feet are so important to that stability is that they're the only contact point between the body and the ground. So if I'm going to have a client doing a bicep curl, I want them to not just engage their core to be strong during the bicep curl, but I'm going to have them also engage their feet, and then their core is technically stronger, and therefore their bicep curl is stronger, right? So we're just thinking about the body in a very integrated way. This is referred to as your deep front fascia line. It runs from the tips of your toes, up your lower leg, through your adductors, pelvic floor, diaphragm, all the way up to the tip of your tongue. So when I teach people how to create foot to core stability, sometimes I'll also call this toe to tongue. So you want to be stable from the tips of your toes all the way to the tip of your tongue. Okay, which is super fun. And that is what we are going to explore right now. And I love having interactive engagement when I do these things. So I'm gonna have you guys join me. Just the way that the computers are, the cameras, I don't see you, so I'm just gonna trust that you're doing it. If not, don't worry, I'll just do it and you can take some notes and then see how it's gonna work. But this is what I'm gonna have you do. So I have my feet here. I'm gonna have all of you stand up and join me. And I'm going to start by having you guys find what a neutral position is. Now, right now I'm barefoot. So I would actually like you guys barefoot if you're in an environment that you could be barefoot. I'm also standing on the Neboso flooring. So this is textured so that if I was your client, you could be using the texture to cue me and build an awareness of where my foot pressure is. So if we all start by standing with our feet shoulder width apart, hands are by your side, and I want you to shut your eyes. Just shut your eyes for a moment and let's tune into our feet. And I want you to feel and find where your passive pressure sits. Passive pressure, passive weight, okay? And if you sat there for a moment and you just assessed, do you feel like your body weight is even between your feet? Or do you feel like you have a little bit more pressure on your left foot, maybe your right foot? And then if you were to assess the front and the back, do you feel like you have more pressure to the front of your feet or to the back of your feet? And then finally, do you feel like you are maybe a little bit more on the inside of your feet or the outside of your feet? So just take a moment and assess. And then I want you to open your eyes and I just want you to think about where that pressure distribution is. If I were to do the assessment, I feel like my pressure is kind of to the outside of my feet and into my heels. So if I was your client and that's where I said that's my pressure, then you could say, well, no wonder, Dr. Emily, it's because you're always on the side of your feet. Why do you think you have IT band issues? Why do you think your hips are always so tight, right? It's because of how you're standing passively throughout the day with so much pressure onto the outside of your feet. So then you would want to teach me how to, quote unquote, find neutral. So what I want you to do is just kind of assess where that was, and then let's find neutral. I want you to keep your feet shoulder width apart. You're going to find your foot tripod, which is underneath your first met head, fifth met head heel. Lift your toes up, spread them nice and wide, and place them back down onto the floor. Now, just doing that, you should feel like you are more balanced in your pressure. And you could do a little assessment and see that, okay? Now, the next layer of what you want to focus on for finding a neutral foot, a much longer conversation than what I have right now, but if you see my feet again, if you look, if I'm standing like this, technically that's pronation, we go into that in the certification, but if you're pronating like this, I need your clients to rotate. So I just externally rotated in my hip, and that put my foot into a more neutral position. So I'm on my tripod, my toes are spread, and then I externally rotated my hips to put me in a neutral position, okay? The final piece to this powerful neutral foot is going to be engagement of our toes. And the way that we're going to do that is through a exercise called the forward lean. Forward lean, you're gonna stay exactly as you are, please. You're going to imagine that you're stiff as a board, stay stiff as a board, please. And I want you to gently rock your body forward. So you're leaning, kind of like a ski jumper, imagine that, right? And then slide back into a vertical position. Again, lean the body forward and then back to a vertical position. So I'm just gonna show you real quick my body from the side. I'm here. And then I'm leaning. So you can see I actually don't even have to lean that far. And then I come back center. I lean and then I come back center. Every time you guys do that, what do you notice happening in your feet? Your toes should be going boom, straight down into the ground. Do you guys feel that? Yes? If you do, guess what? I was activating a postural reflex. That postural reflex is a really easy way that you can get your clients to activate their feet without doing a complex cueing about toes and engagement and all of this. Simply do the forward lean and it will do this reflex. Now, if you want to bring it a little bit more specifically, you want to be able to do that engagement with your toes without doing the forward lean. When I do this, I like to teach people one foot at a time so I can be all centered on my right foot and then release. Push my toes into the ground and then release. So I got my focus on just one foot, okay? You can take your time going through each foot, engage, and then to get it into your core, what I'm gonna have you guys do is go back to your feet shoulder width apart, foot tripod, spread toes nice and tall. And this time, as you lean forward and you feel your toes pushing into the ground, I want you to engage your transverse abdominals, engage your center of gravity, and then bring it back to a vertical position. Lean forward, engage your transverse abdominals, and then bring it back. Now, as you lean forward, the last little piece is just see what it feels like if you put your tongue to your palate. So I'm leaning forward, and then I bring it back. I can't put my tongue to my palate and talk to you guys. Sorry, so just try it again. Lean forward and then bring it back, okay? Now, your trick again is can you engage your feet, engage your core, tongue to palate without the forward lean and then release? I like to use breath to guide this as well. So the way that I would do that is I would tell the client, inhale through your nose, into your belly. And then as you exhale, keep exhaling, engage your core, keep exhaling, push your toes down. Try not to do the forward lean this time. Keep exhaling, bring your tongue to your palate and release. Great. So just real quick, how I tie that with clients, right? Is let's say I'm doing, I don't have my dumbbells with me, but let's say I'm doing a bicep curl. It's the exercise for today, I guess, is I'm going to set my base, spread my toes, engage them, engage my core, toes go down into the ground. Technically, that's called short foot. And then I'm holding the dumbbells and every time I curl, I'm pushing my toes into the ground. I'm engaging my transverse abdominals as I do that bicep curl. And release. You could do the same thing with a squat. You could do anything with an overhead press. You could do it with a lunge. But that foundation of foot to core stability, that's what we're going after. Okay. Good, good, good. It's called short foot. It's called foot to core, toe to tongue. It is powerful, powerful, powerful. Okay. Power, the power of foot to core. Look how perfect that was. Okay. So that is going to be your second layer, is that we are focusing on strength. And when I talk about strength, this is where I am saying it is integrated strength. Strong feet have to be connected to a strong core. Otherwise, your feet are not strong. They got to be connected, integrated. Okay. Your third layer, as we're wrapping this up here, is that we are going into recovery. And the focus of recovery is going to be our circulatory system. Okay. That circulatory system, to have sufficient recovery, you have to have proper circulation. You got to get the garbage out. Right? And one of the best ways to recover, the best ways to recover the foot and the ankle and the muscles of your lower leg is through movement. And the reason that movement is such a powerful driver to circulation is because your calf is actually considered your second heart. How cool is that? And every time your ankle moves up and down like a pump, it brings that blood back up to the heart. So one of the most important things for optimal, just total body recovery, is that you have to get your foot and ankle moving, which is really walking is the best way to do it. But it's, you want to get that ankle driving contractions. Okay, so movement, calf pump, muscles contracting is a way that we want to drive recovery and circulation. Now, could you also use sensory stimulation, which, as I had said, is one of my favorite topics is how do we bring in sensory stimulation to optimize recovery? And I'm going to go into a couple. It's not just Nervoso. There's a couple other sensory stimulation. One of my other favorite sensory stimulants for recovery is going to be vibration. And here we're talking about the whole body vibration platform. So if you're familiar with them, if they're in any of the facilities that you might train out of, this is just one example of using whole body vibration and it increased skin blood flow. So they're showing that just 10 minutes of sitting your feet on a whole body vibration platform increased that foot circulation, which meant recovery to your feet, okay? Which is really, really important. This one, which I love, is showing that after just 50 steps, you get an increase in skin temperature and skin circulation. I often get asked that if people, their feet are always cold, maybe they have Raynaud's, which is like a microspasm where like their toes can turn white and blue and different colors from circulation. I always get asked, like, what are different ways that I can increase circulation to my feet, right? Or if you do work with the older clients, circulation is a big concern. So here we already have whole body vibration platform, awesome. Walking, taking just 50 steps, that's huge, can increase circulation to the feet, therefore supporting recovery. Love it as well. Here's another one. If you allow the vibration of ground reaction forces to get into the foot, guess what? How does the body and the foot absorb the vibration coming in? The muscles have to contract, right? So by wearing minimal shoes and doing more barefoot movements, you force the foot to contract. And it really is foot contractions, muscle contractions that drive that circulation process. Okay. This is actually one study that showed, just in case if you're really into minimal shoes, here's a huge argument for you. It was showing that if you wore minimal shoes and just walked, like daily walking in them, there was a 21% increase in FDB, is your flexor digitorum brevis, but an intrinsic muscle size. That's huge, right? You're actually showing hypertrophy of foot muscles from wearing minimal shoes. And the reason is that sensory information is going through, so you are getting that contraction. And then, of course, you drive circulation, right? It's all about circulation. And then finally, we gotta talk about Nervoso and texture, right? Is the ability to increase circulation using some sort of texture. And of course, we have seen research studies around this where they will use texture to then stimulate into your dermal layer, because the dermal layer is where the microcirculation sits. The epidermis is the exterior. One layer deeper is the dermal layer, and that's where your microcirculation sits. So what's cool about the pyramid texture on Nervoso is think the pyramids can actually penetrate into the dermis. They obviously don't break the skin, but it penetrates to then get that microcirculation stimulated, which is awesome. Love it, love it. Here's an example of our recovery socks. You can see the little indents. We call that the Nervoso effect. And when people see that, when they use our products, I just want you to think of that as like, yes, I'm doing something healthy for my nervous system. I'm doing something healthy for my circulation. And then of course you're releasing the muscles as well, which is great. So as we wrap this up, and I know that there's some prizes for you guys, there's time for some questions. I want to summarize this for you guys so you can have your key takeaways that you can implement right away, okay? You got this pyramid of healthy feet. This three-step pyramid are little steps that you want to do every single day. The way that I integrate this, let's say with a patient or in your case with a client, I'll tell you exactly how to structure it throughout their day. Activation. I would tell my clients, your patient or your clients, my patients, to release their feet every day, 5 minutes in the morning when they wake up on the neural ball, right? You get the activation, you get the circulation, you get that textural stimulation. So you got 5-point foot release, first thing in the morning, do it when you brush your teeth, right? You kill two birds with one stone, which is awesome. Walk around barefoot in your home while you are waking up and getting ready. You of course put slide on the socks if you want, and that's getting the stimulation as well. But for me personally, every morning. I actually walk around in our duo insoles. These are in my house slippers. That's part of how I wake up. And then I do the neural ball release. Boom, checked it off the list. Didn't even have to take any time away from anything else. Two, strength. What I have people do still while they're getting ready. Ladies putting on makeup, or you're waiting for the coffee to be made, something like that is the strength, that forward lean, right? So let's say you release the feet, you're still brushing your teeth, you're getting ready. Okay, you did the neural ball release, awesome. Okay, find neutral, okay? Forward lean, do your forward lean 5 to 8 times, make sure you're coordinating your breath and your foot to core, boom, that's it. 5 to 8 times, and you did something for your integrated strength. I absolutely love it. And then when the client trains with you, you are going to cue them a little bit more intentful, toes down, core in, exhale, when they do their exercises. And then finally, end of the day, you're done training clients, or your client is back home, say, guess what? That recovery, slide on the recovery socks, release your feet on the neural ball again when you brush your teeth, because you got to brush your teeth twice, right? Do it again so you get that recovery and that reset. So I want that to be a demonstration on how easy it is to start to think about little tiny habits that you and your clients can do every single day to make a big impact on overall foot health and movement longevity. Super easy to do. And of course, you can expand much, much further on this with other intentful exercises. But this is my go-to way to really help people start to get into that foot health mindset. I really thank you guys for your time. This is the Barefoot Training Specialist certification through ISSA. And I know that John's going to be coming back on to share some information, but definitely do check out the Barefoot Training Specialist. There's a level one and a level two. Level one is all about understanding foot anatomy, foot to core, the fascial lines, the sensory side of the foot, and then of course some programming and then assessments. So really, really powerful course for you guys.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for all that information. Hopefully you guys were taking notes. And there was a question in the chat asking how you can rewatch this. And everyone who registered for this is going to be receiving a link to be able to watch this via email tomorrow. So whatever email you submitted in order to register, that's how you're going to receive a copy of this webinar. So we do have a couple of things that we want to get done before we wrap up today. We've got some offers that we want to talk about. We've got a couple of prizes to give away. And someone did mention in the chat that the neural ball and some socks seem like a must-have. Well, you have an opportunity here. Again, we have these offers, we have the prizes, and then we do have some questions. So the special offers for today from Nebozo products, you can get 20% off at nebozo.com/ISSA. Use that code ISSA20. And then as far as specializations, like the Barefoot Training Specialist, you can get an extra $100 off all specializations, but again, including that Barefoot Training Specialist, and you're going to want to use the code NEBOSO100. All right, we have some prizes to give away, and hopefully I've got some names sent my way so I can announce who is going to win the neural ball and those recovery socks. Hopefully it's that person who commented that they are a must-have. And then we are giving away a free specialization of your choice. Could be the Barefoot Training Specialist. So the Nebozo Neural Ball and Recovery Socks are going to Jenny Gaitan or Gaitan. So congratulations. Hopefully you're the one who wanted the Neural Ball and the Recovery Socks. I'm assuming all of you did. So I'm assuming you're going to be happy with that. And then for our one free specialization from ISSA, our winner is Terry Keller. Terry Keller. So again, for the Neural Ball and the Recovery Socks, we got Jenny Gaitan or Gaitan. And for the one free specialization, we have Terry Keller. You'll be receiving some information from us so that you can claim your prizes. So congratulations. So again, we do have some questions for you, Dr. Emily. So we've got a few minutes here. Hopefully we can address all of these before we wrap up today. Okay, so our first question, if someone has feet issues, like a collapsing arch, what are some recommended shoes or accessories to have?
Yes, so let me go general on it, because there's actually many different types of flat feet. You may want to look at using something like an over-the-counter arch support, possibly. The one that I do recommend for my patients is PowerStep. You can get it on Amazon. It's like 40 bucks. So it's not a huge investment for these individuals. And then for a kind of going true biomechanics, you would want them to have a slight heel toe drop. So most minimal shoes are zero drop. You would actually find more of a transitional drop, which will be 4 to 6 millimeters. And you're giving them just a little bit more control in that foot. But that's what I would look at initially. And then of course, you have a whole rabbit hole to dive in that I could go into like hours and hours of explaining the differentiation, but that's a really good question. And if you do come across things like that, then that's a reason for you to kind of start to dive down that rabbit hole.
Yeah, and the good thing with that with Dr. Emily is if you want to deep dive a lot of this information, she's got tons of information out there, plenty of videos out there, tons of great information. Next question, and this was asked when you were talking about stimulation. The question was, how does this work for people with neuropathy?
Love that question. Great question. Yes. So neuropathy, which is oftentimes sensory, so it's sensory neuropathy, means that there's decrease, not necessarily complete, but decreased sensation in the foot. And using different stimulation. So we actually have done pilots with Neboso and neuropathy. We're actually doing an IRB controlled research study, and we had profound effects that people had quote unquote numbness from neuropathy, and they actually felt the Neboso texture and it improved their foot awareness, their balance. They felt much more confident when moving because they could actually feel their feet again and feel the ground. So not that I just advocate Neboso on it, but just realize that neuropathy and I can't feel my feet, I am quoting this because it's what they would be saying, doesn't mean that they're completely void. So get them on the vibration platform, get them on harder surfaces, try the Neboso products, try a trigger point release to try to wake up those nerves.
Great, thank you for that. Okay, next question. So do you do this 5-point exercise before every workout? Or should this be daily or maybe 2 times per day?
Oh my gosh, all of the above.
All of the above.
5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes in the evening. That's really what I recommend for every person. But then if you're working out, you want to use it as an activation. Let's wake up the foot. Let's wake up the muscles. So then I would say on those days, technically they're doing it 3 times a day, right? And it's super easy to do. It takes, 2 minutes to do it.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff is really pretty simple. And just to share this, when I first took some of your education way back when, I kind of thought of it as kind of advanced personal trainer education. But what I really found out was a lot of the stuff was fundamental to just being a healthy, happy human. And that's why it really, really struck me as important information, because although I looked at it as advanced, I found out that this was fundamental stuff for everybody. So thank you again for that. You mentioned that walking can be a good way to get some recovery for a number of reasons. Did you have any recommendations, specific recommendations for how much?
For how much walking?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I would say your clients, just keep them active. I'm sure we've all had the workout where you're like, whoa, I can't even move the next day. Where really the best thing that you could do is to go back to the gym and just lightly walk on the treadmill. Just get those muscles contracting, which gets the muscles moving, the blood moving, the ankle pump. Another way is if they are like super sore on it, is using things like the Normatec boots are really good because it's focusing on circulation. You could just go in and do vibration platform as a way when you're really sore. But the movement is really, you will recover much faster from that damage essentially that you've done to the muscles and the tissue by at least doing something minimal moving.
Got it. So kind of building off of that, now we're going to talk about minimal shoes. If you choose to wear minimal shoes, so this sounds like someone who's thinking about it. If you choose to wear minimal shoes, do you have to commit to wearing them all the time?
Oh, no. Oh my gosh, absolutely not. So the way that I have people transition from traditional shoes to more minimal shoes, one of the best places to do it is in the gym. And if you're thinking, hey, I'm going to do, my normal workout, unless the workout is very highly ballistic, Well, let's say you're doing just traditional squats, upper body, you know, maybe a few machines and stuff like that. Then that is one of the best controlled environments for wearing the minimal shoes. And that's where I'll have people do their adaptation to it. Then I'll have people do it maybe around their home or around the office. I practiced in New York City for 10 years, so which is massive walking city. So it was very different how I would guide those individuals to transition to minimal shoes. If you're more in like a driving city, it's a little bit easier to kind of transition to minimal shoes. And then just make sure that you slowly increase the time. I will say that I have many, many patients who are personal trainers and they train their clients all day on their feet, like 8 to 10 hours a day, and they wear minimal shoes and then they get plantar fasciitis. So just make sure that you realize that standing is actually really hard on the body. It's not natural to stand long hours. It's natural to move. Your body is designed to move. Your body is not designed to sit and your body is not designed to stand. So prolonged periods on either of those, you got to do a reset, right? But you could offset that by doing a neuro ball release.
Got it. Thank you for that. So my takeaway from that is to kind of start slowly. I think we've both known a lot of people who heard that minimal shoes are good for you. So then they buy minimal shoes and start training for a marathon. And that's probably not quite the way to go about it, right?
Right.
All right. Next up, what would you recommend for clients already experiencing plantar fasciitis?
So make sure that they see someone. That's what I would say. It's probably the easiest one. To get a consultation, a lot of people don't ever go to a consultation and they try to treat it themselves or through all of their friends trying to tell them how to treat it. So I would just say, hey, if it's consistent and they've had it for more than like a month, and I would say, hey, just go see a podiatrist and they can check it out. And then you'd be able to guide them a little bit better through that. But with plantar fasciitis, I never do a no pain, no gain thing. I also don't do that anymore after I turn 40. I really listen to the body. So you don't want to no pain, no gain it. There's a reason why the foot keeps talking to them and they need to give it that true rest and recovery.
Got it. And, you know, I've been there. I've been there with the plantar fasciitis and it is debilitating. So I hear you on that one. Okay. So we had another question and it's kind of, I guess this person's trying to adjust to injury. They've had multiple healed fractures and some nerve damage and modifying things have become a necessary part of their life. That's kind of broad, but is that something you can speak on in terms of how this person can approach, foot care? Because I'm assuming what they're talking about is these fractures and nerve damage are in the feet.
Can they message me?
Reach out to Dr. Emily.
Yeah.
That is a big question, but an important question for sure.
Yes. Yeah. No. Definitely reach out, but I it's probably a long answer.
And bear with me one second. I'm seeing if we've got any more that have come through here. It looks like that might be the end of the questions. Dr. Emily, anything else that you'd want to add to any of the questions that I just asked, or anything else that you'd like to add before we start to wrap things up here?
I'd say the last thing is that I really liked your comment about feet and thinking about feet and foot recovery or shoes or foot placement as really fundamental, not necessarily advanced. And I think that that's a key takeaway that I would like the listeners to have as well. And think of it almost as up there important with breathing and how it's really important to understand the power of breath during different exercises, the type of breath, the coordination of breath, the timing of it. And that's how I look at feet as well, is it's as fundamental as breath.
Absolutely. And it does look like we do have one other question here. And it's again asking about if the ball would help with neuropathy. But then this person also says, I teach older adults and do barefoot training through yoga, but looking for more things to do, more exercises to help them with this.
Yeah, so I would honestly check out the Nobosso products and, disclaimer mentioned on that, I loaned them, but they're really easy to incorporate the NeuroBall if you want. Obviously, you're going to be doing balance exercises. Anyone who has neuropathy, you're going to be thinking about fall risk, right? And what do you do with that client to mitigate their fall risk? Well, step one is you need them to feel their feet. So could you do that through barefoot on an Ebosil mat? Could you do that by teaching them how to do short foot in the forward lean, bring the insoles into the shoes? You're doing things that helps them to really build that awareness. We also have a kinesis board, which is a micro wobble board. So it's not like a Bosu, it's very micro perturbed. That's great as well. And then looking at, I have a lot of videos, as John had said, on YouTube, where I have a lot of lectures on neuropathy. And you could even go to YouTube and search Dr. Emily Neuropathy, and you will probably find several lectures from me where I go into a lot of the science of neuropathy and how to start to address it.
Awesome, awesome. Well, Dr. Emily, thank you so much for sharing all this information. Again, for all of you listeners out there, I truly believe this is fundamental information for everyone's health and fitness. And doing a deep dive into the education that Dr. Emily has to offer can be a game changer, especially for a lot of you out there who are working with people with a lot of these issues, the plantar fasciitis, the neuropathy, etc. So again, Dr. Emily, thank you so much for sharing all that information. Congratulations again to Jenny and to Terry, our prize winners today. Again, keep in mind, you will all be receiving a copy of this via email, so you'll be able to watch it again and go back and kind of listen to Dr. Emily explain some of the basics of how to take care of your feet, because again, it is a fundamental thing. I'm just now realizing I never did actually introduce myself at the beginning. My name is John Bauer. I'm one of the content developers here at ISSA. And this was exciting to be able to have you, Dr. Emily, on. So again, thank you so much for coming on. And thank you all for joining us today. And I'll look forward to seeing all of you again next time when we have another great webinar for you all.
Thank you.